Yeah, I've had a few people recently leaving comments on various videos and asking, how do you finish your stitching? So as far as I understand it, what they mean is, you know, they know how to do the stitching, they've gone around the stitching. When they get to the end of the stitching run, you know, how do you actually go about finishing that stitching off and make sure it's neat and strong and everything? I think it's been covered in some other videos, but we'll recap it today just as a quick one. So I'm stitching this little pouch round here. I've gone most of the way around the pouch and I've got about 3 stitches left. So I'm saddle stitching this as normal, just as has been shown in the other videos. And crucially, whatever order you're doing stuff in might be slightly different to me, but in a minute what we're going to do is we're going to reverse the order that we're doing things. Okay, so as I'm coming down here, I'm putting my back needle in first. I'm coming underneath that needle. I'm going in the bottom of my hole, dropping my loop down and pulling up my stitch. Okay. So I'm going in the back, underneath, and the bottom. That's the order of the things that I'm doing, okay? So back needle in, underneath, bottom of the hole, down through my loop, back needle in, underneath, bottom of the hole, down through the loop. Okay, that's my standard stitch. That's how I'm stitching everything like that. So now I've completed the stitching run. I've got down to the last hole here. So we're ready to actually finish the stitching off. Now, when you get to the end of a stitching run, you, depending on what you're sewing, you may also form a binding stitch. Now, a binding stitch is an extra stitch that goes over the edge of some leather to help add strength when two pieces come together. And it just depends on the kind of item that you're making as to whether you'll be doing that. So on a pouch like this, it's a little Swiss Army knife slip pouch. Somebody's going to be putting the knife in and out, and they're going to be pulling apart on the sides of this to pinch the knife and get the knife in and out. So in this case, to make this nice and strong, stop this pulling apart here, I have binding stitches going around this edge to make that a little bit stronger. Okay, on something like a knife sheath where you get to the top, you wouldn't need to because it's that much thicker that you've got much more pressure on the stitching and so on. But on something thin like this, or on something where, for example, you might have formed up the front of a bag and you're attaching it to the back of a bag, when you get to the top of that seam, often you'll bind that round. So you'll have seen that as an example sometimes. So to do my binding stitch, I'm just going to loop this over the edge, go back through the hole and pull this down. Snug that into position. And let's give that a little bit of pressure. So as I say, you might not be doing that. It depends on what you're doing. But if you're not doing it, just pretend that I haven't just done that. Okay, so once we've finished the run, what we get is essentially a piece of thread coming out of either side of the last hole, and now we're ready to finish. So we finish off this stitching by doing what's called backstitching, and backstitching means basically reversing the direction that we've just come and doing everything in reverse. So if you remember, I came in through the back hole, I came underneath the needle, I went into the bottom of that hole, and then I came out of the other side. So I'm now going to reverse what I did. So rather than doing the back needle first, I'm going to do the front needle like that. Instead of coming underneath it, I'm going to go on top of it. I'm going to pull through, and then instead of coming to the bottom of the hole, I'm going to come out of the top of the hole. And then I'm going to pull that through. So okay, so I've done everything backwards. What I'm going to do then is I'm going to pull this up, but when I pull it up, rather than just pulling it tight, I'm going to guide it into position. So every time we do backstitching, we end up with two bits of stitching laying through the same hole. And what we want to do is, rather than get it laid at the side, we want it to lay as much as we can on top of the previous stitching. And that way it doesn't look as bulky. It's very difficult to make it look invisibly so, but as much as you can, try and lay it on top. So I'm going to pull it up here. And as it nearly disappears, it's trying to curl round and be awkward, this one. I'm going to guide, just sort of lifting with my needle, and I'm pulling it as much as I can over that previous stitch. And then the same on the back. Once I've got it loosely laid, then I'm going to snug it into position. And now normally, when I pull in my stitches up, I'm pulling a little bit down with my right hand and a little bit up with my left hand as I pull these. Again, we're going to reverse that, so I'm pulling a little bit up with my right hand, down with my left hand. Okay, and that snugs that into position. And what it looks like is a slightly fatter stitch, but it doesn't look like two bits of thread laid at the side of each other. Okay, now that's a back stitch. So the question is, how many back stitches do we do? Well, as standard, I would do what's called 2.5 back stitches. So it means I'm going to do that whole thing again once, and then I'm going to do 1/2, which, because what you always want is the threads to finish on the same side. Okay, so when you saddle stitch, obviously normally every time you complete a stitch, one thread comes out of either side of the piece. When you finish your stitching, you want both threads coming out of the back, or whatever is most appropriately the back of the item. Some things very obviously have a back. Some things that are like a wallet, for example, there isn't really a back of a wallet, there's an inside and an outside. So you're going to finish the stitching wherever it's most discreet. But whatever you class as the back of the item or the side that you want to finish on, that's where the thread comes, and that will be the half stitch. So a standard 2.5. So that would be 1, we'll do 2, and we'll do a half. Something which was going to get a lot of pressure, which needed a little bit more strength, I might do 3 and then a half. But really, that's the only variation, either do 2.5 or 3.5. Okay, so the second back stitch. So again, we do everything in reverse. So the front needle goes in. We go on top of the front needle, pull through, come into the top side of the hole, pull through. I close up most of my loops. As my loop nearly comes closed, I use my needle. I just guide that thread on top as much as I can, make it as neat as it can be. Same on the back side, guide my thread on top. Once it's done loosely, pulling in the opposite direction and snug. And now I do my half stitch, so I could ignore this back needle. Now we're finished with that. I'm just going to come in the front here, pull that through, and I'm guiding this to the back. So again, now I'm just picked up that other needle, and I'm just going to use that to help me pull that as much as I can on top of that other thread there. And then I pull that down. So what we've got here is, this is also the front that you're looking at. On the back side, we've now got both threads on the back. Okay, now let's look what we do to neaten those up. Okay, so this has come out of the pony now, and you're now looking at the back side of the item. So here's both threads coming out of the back. So we can see that will be the first back stitch we completed, that will be the second back stitch we completed, and then this here is essentially the half back stitch that we did. So we've got both threads there, and they're coming out of basically the third and fourth holes as you look at the back of the item. Okay, so we now need to sort this out. So the next thing we do is we snip off the thread. Now, I've seen people do this in different ways. I've seen some people do it with a scalpel, like this. What they do is pull the thread away like that, place the scalpel against the back of the item, and then pull the thread against the scalpel to snip it off. I would not recommend you do that, because you're basically putting a scalpel blade against the back of your finished item, and if you push in the wrong way with that, or slip in the wrong way, all you're going to do is simply slice into the back of your item. So I wouldn't recommend you do that. The easiest thing is to use some of these little thread snippers. Now, these are Tandy ones, but you will find these at any old sewing suppliers. They all look the same, basically. These Tandy ones, just they're the same as the other ones, but they've got plastic around, so they're a little bit more comfortable to use. But the inside of them, these little kind of mini bypass things, any kind of sewing place sells these, and they're only a couple of quid, so these are invaluable. They'll let you get quite close to the thread. If you try and snip with scissors like this, they're much more awkward. Okay, so what we do is we just snip these off, and we want to snip fairly close. We're not trying to get right down into the hole and snipping the hole or anything. We're just coming up against the leather and basically just nipping those off like that. And once you've trimmed the thread, what you're left with is essentially two little fuzzy bits sticking up, which is the end of your thread. And the next thing we do is we address those little fuzzy bits. Now, if you're using any sort of synthetic thread, like I do, all the Tiger thread is braided polyester. Polyester is a synthetic material. You can melt it. Okay, anything that you can melt, melt. If you're using something that won't melt, like linen, then you, well, there's not much else you can do with it apart from that. I would possibly just try and trim it a little bit closer than that and leave it. You can't really do a rylet else with it. But a lot of the synthetic threads will melt. If you're not sure whether you're using a thread that will melt, or you're not sure what thread it is, then try melting it. So if we take a bit of Tiger thread like this that's on the end of that needle, and we offer this up to a flame and try melting it, you'll see that that's basically melting into a kind of ball on the end, and it's going into a little black melted ball. If we take some linen thread like this, I honestly can't actually remember the last time I sewed anything with linen thread, but if we try and melt this linen thread, you'll see that it's basically just set on fire. Okay, it's not melting into a ball, it's just kind of charring away. Okay, so once we've trimmed the thread off, we want to melt these bits. Now, there's a couple of different ways you can do this. Depending on what leather is, depends on how much you need to fiddle about with it. If you're using something like this, this is horsehide, it's natural horsehide, it's a light colour. If I apply a flame next to these to melt them, it is likely going to char the edge of that leather, and it's very difficult to cover that up. If you char the edge of it, it's not going to polish out or anything. It will damage the leather. If I was doing something like a knife sheath and I was doing thicker, darker leather, then for the amount of time you need to put a flame against something like that, it's literally just touching to it like that and off again. It's fine, okay? So if you can't put a naked flame next to your leather, there's a couple of different things you can do. On a disposable lighter like this, which has got a metal kind of shieldy bit that goes around the flame, obviously, so it doesn't melt. If you invert the lighter like this and set it going like that, and then give it sort of, you know, 10, 15, 20 seconds, what you're doing is you're heating up that metal bit on the lighter, and then once it's hot enough, you can turn that round, place it against the thread, and that will be warm enough to just melt that bit of thread. That's one way to do it. You can also buy these things. You might have seen this in the last video. This is called a thread zap. These are very cheap and they do essentially the same job as that. So rather than messing about with a disposable lighter, I would just go on Amazon and get yourself one of these. They're only about £6. This basically, you put some batteries in it, and it's got a very thin bit of wire on the tip here. When you press this button on the side, it passes current from the batteries through the tip, and because it's only thin wire, it heats the wire very quickly. These are designed for sewing things. This is by far the easiest thing to use for this. So all you do is press the button on the side. It doesn't need very long at all, 3, 4, 5 seconds. The tip will get hot enough, and then you can very carefully, being careful obviously not to go through any of the threads, only on the ends you've got there. And the reason that you are wanting to melt the ends like that is when you melt the end, it's kind of like peening the top of a rivet almost, but with thread. What you're doing is you're increasing the size of the end of the thread by making essentially like a little smushed up ball. And what that will help to do is stop that thread wanting to pull at any point back through that hole to the other side. It kind of helps just to lock it in on that side. Not by the same degree as a rivet, but it just gives it an extra little bit of strength. Okay, so once you've got that melted down, basically that is your stitching all done. But as always, you will then hammer your stitching. So the final way to finish stitching off is to take your cobbler's hammer and hammer around the stitching, and that will even out and flatten the stitching and give it the final appearance. Okay, so that's how we finish stitching. Binding stitch if you need it, back stitch. 2.5 or 3 times, depending on the strength, as standard, really 2.5 times. Trim your threads off nice and close, melt them if they're meltable, and then give your stitching a hammer. And if you repeat that process, you should find that you get a nice, neat ending to your stitch that's nice and strong every single time. And although this is only a small item, I would do exactly the same thing if it was a 4-layer thick knife sheath or anything like that. As with pulling a stitch through, it's really the same thing every time. It's just the item that changes. Okay, hope that's been useful for you.